In today's session of numerical methods, I like to do a coding session with you. So we will write some code, and I prepared a small excursion. So recall we have discussed the Monte Carlo method, and as a special variant, a special version of it, the Monte Carlo integral. So we can approximate an integral. Yeah, so maybe I just write this again here. So of course we can transform the domain, but written here is the domain 0, 1 to the power of d. So in d dimensions, we approximate here this guy in a certain sense. So there was a probabilistic version. And we also had this nice pointwise result, the Coxmann-Lafka inequality, so which was not probabilistic, using here a sequence of numbers, yeah, random numbers, if we interpret it in the probabilistic way. So that were here the xi of omega. And then, of course, the next session was, how do we generate the sequence? So we had many sessions on how to generate random numbers. And the Monte Carlo method can be very easily parallelized. So, and you see this immediately from this thing here, because this is here a sum over a sequence, so f of xi. And I can just split this sum into subsequences, sums over subsequences, and then take the sum over these sums. And I can calculate each subsequence in parallel. So that motivates that we maybe discuss a little bit the parallelization. Okay, so the Monte Carlo method in its original form uses a sequence of independent, yeah, so identically distributed random variables. And this independence implies that individual calculations can be performed independently. Yeah? So there's no link between f of xi and f of xj. It's just independent function evaluation. So this means that the method is almost trivial to parallelize. So in other words, Monte Carlo integration or the Monte Carlo method is, well, in most situations, a classic example of embarrassingly parallel compute problem. So this term here, embarrassingly parallel, is a technical term. So from distributed computing. So a problem is embarrassingly parallel if you can easily split it into subproblems that can be calculated in parallel. So you can look this term up, for example, here on Wikipedia. You know, and you also find that Monte Carlo is an example for this. So what do I need with respect to parallelization? So if you think back, I mentioned the sum can be interpreted as a sum over smaller sums. So for this, I need here that we can have a sequence, so a random number sequence or sequence of quasi-random numbers, from which we can easily construct subsequences. So I have a very long sequence, yeah, 100 million elements, and I split it into 10 subsequences, each having 10 million. And I can calculate these on, say, 10 different cores of my machine in parallel. Well, not all random number generators or not all sequences allow this. So this is maybe a problem. So to write this here, the mathematical formulation is embarrassingly parallel, but it may happen that the implementation you use is not. So the mathematical problem is embarrassingly parallel. But the specific implementation is maybe not embarrassingly parallel. Okay, so we have to talk a little bit about subsequences, if I like to do this in parallel. So let's talk about subsequences. So there are different options how we can generate a subsequence. If you think about our session on the van der Korput or the Halton sequence, they have the very nice feature that you can explicitly calculate the element xi as a function of the index. So the van der Korput sequence was of the type that xi is equal, and then comes some algorithm or formula that uses the I to construct the element. So there is no problem. So that's maybe the reason why I will start maybe with this, yeah, to show you a little bit the parallelization. But then if you think of our LCGs, so the linear concurrential generators, okay, there the description or the definition of the sequence was xi or xi plus one, so the next element, is a function of xi, of the previous element. So the definition was already sequential, so it was one after the other. So it's not clear how to parallelize this. So you have to work a little bit to find, let's say, an explicit expression for the case element, such that you can start your subsequent at a given xk. So you can use this sequential definition for each subsequence. So xk plus one is equal to a function of xk, but you need, if you would like to initialize everything in parallel, you need some formula to know how does element xk look like. And there are some formulas that do this. So this is sometimes called skip ahead. Yeah. So can you skip a certain part very quickly? And I have here a reference where you can have a look at how you can perform a skip ahead for a linear concurrential generator. Yeah? So that's here this first paper, yeah, in this list of references. Okay, so some algorithms, some sequences allow for a skip ahead. And we need that if we like to parallelize this. So, and then if we talk about parallelization, we could just use an implementation of a random number generator, so like Mersenne Twister, and just call it in parallel. So we just ask him, give me the next number, and then multiple parallel threads ask the same generator. So we could think about using just one generator and share it across parallel executions. This is sometimes dangerous. Your implementation has to be thread safe. I will comment on this later because we will see that there is an implementation that is not thread safe. Also, it's not guaranteed that this is efficient. Yeah, it may be that the generator actually blocks the parallelism and performs each call after the other because the generator knows that it cannot perform the calculation of the random number in parallel. No? So I will also have an example for this where we perform a parallelization, yeah, which looks parallel, but in fact it's even slower as the sequential. Then in one of our last session we had the concept of the seed. Yeah, so the seed is just say some state that specifies the initial value or the initial state of the generator. And we had the remark that if two generators have the same seed, they will generate the same sequence. But also, if we use different seed, we will likely get different sequences. Well, often we get always a different sequence, but there was the small warning that it's not 100% clear that the sequences are independent. So it may happen that if you have two sequences and the seed for the second sequence is something like the second number of the first sequence, then you actually have the same sequences. They are just shifted by one element. So that may happen. It's rare, but it may happen. And therefore, you have to be careful to perform the parallelization by just using many sequences with different initial values, with different seeds. It's here on the slide. So if the sequence is generated from a seed, so then we may consider the generation of different sequences with different seeds. So it works comparatively well, but you have to be a little bit aware of this, that this is maybe not an accurate solution, because two different seeds may generate similar, just slightly different sequences. So for example, shifted. So now we have some options on parallelizing the Monte Carlo method. With respect to implementation, I will perform now the implementation in Java, and I will use two different frameworks. So I've used the Stream API, which very easily allows to parallelize a calculation, because you may use here this stream.parallel, and he will perform all calculations on the stream in parallel. But maybe a small remark, the Stream API is just for very simple independent calculations, and you should be a little bit careful when you perform parallelization with the Stream API. It's maybe not written for parallelization as the main purpose. A framework that is specifically for parallelization is the executor framework and the concept of so-called futures. So I will also use that. So the executor framework is just that you have an executor that can execute a task. So you have an executor that can execute a task, and you distribute task to this executor, and he can execute different tasks in parallel. You can specify the parallelism, and you immediately get the result of this task, but not in terms of the true result, in terms of a handle on the future result. So this is called future. So to write this here, this is something like a handle on the result, which will be available at a future time. So if you perform on this future, so let's say result is now a future, the operation get, then this will wait for the result. So the technique you implement this is you first distribute all tasks to the executor, and you get this future as a return value. Then after you have collected all those futures, you are sure that all the tasks are running in parallel, and you call get on all the futures. And of course, this will wait until the first get is finished, and then he will just call the next get. Maybe it has finished before, that doesn't matter. And you collect all the result. So it is a little bit more explicit. And maybe that's nice that we then also look at this. We distribute the work, and we collect the result. So let's have a small session on this. And as an application, I like to use the exercise or example that we had, well, some time ago in the Monte Carlo session, namely the calculation of P by integrating the unit circle. So Monte Carlo integration can calculate an integral. And here I like to calculate the integral I, which integrates the indicator function. Yeah, so we integrate here the indicator function. X and Y are inside the unit circle. So since my Monte Carlo method is written in integrate over 0, 1, and here in two dimensions, 0, 1 squared. So I just transform the integral. So this can be interpreted as a scaling, or as a translation and scaling, or you can just interpret it as taking four times, the upper left, upper right segment. So it can be interpreted as taking four times the upper right segment. So I like to calculate here this area. And we know that the area here is P. So something like that. And well, of course, the area of this guy here is 4, 2 by 2. So here we have 1, okay, and here we have 1 minus 1. So if I calculate here this integral, I'm actually calculating P. So let's do this code session. Approximate P via Monte Carlo integration. And we will use different sequences and different implementations. Okay, so let's start here. Yeah, I created here an empty package called parallelization experiment. So let's create a new class. So let's call this Monte Carlo integration parallelization experiment. I need a main method. So I just write everything here in this single class. Yeah, it's just a demo. Yeah, so I do not use interfaces, classes, and so on. So I just want to demo a little bit how we use this framework and how they behave and how we can perform parallelization. So common to all these guys is the number of sample points. We like to use the number of samples. So let's take here 20 million. Yeah, so this here is now 2 × 10⁻⁷. Yeah, so 20 million sample. So maybe we have to use larger. And let's start with the first test. So we test using the Holton sequence with the stream API, and we use it in sequential form. So I don't do parallelization. So I just want to show you first the result without parallelization. So let's write this method. Okay, so what do we need? So I like to calculate an approximation for P. So that is my approximation for P by integrating this integral. So I know that it is P is 4 times. Integrate the upper right segment. So I integrate with the Holton sequence. So I use an integer stream, which just gives me the index. The index runs from 0 to number of samples. So I need number of samples here as an argument. So I pass this here to my method. So this is number of samples. Okay, so now I have an integer stream. the index of the number. So, and from the index of the number, I can calculate with the function. So the element of the sequence. So what is this function? So the Holton sequence is now in two dimensions. Okay, so I have an x. So my x is 2 times the Holton sequence. So maybe we take that one because that has directly a function that gives me the Holton number. So I need 2 times the Holton sequence at the index I, and then I take a Holton sequence in 2 dimensions, so I'd have 2 different base values. So I use 2 and 3. So my y uses the Holton sequence at I for 3. And here I perform here the transformation 2 times the random number between 0 and 1 minus 1/2. So that's here on the slide. So I generate x and y in, or let's call it u, maybe I call it u and v, yeah, because it is a substitution. I generate u and v in the unit cube from 0, 1 squared, and then I transform it to x and y by taking u minus 1/2, then it's between minus 1/2 and plus 1/2 times 2, then it's between minus 1 and plus 1. So this here is then my sampling of the points x and y. Okay, so, and then I have to evaluate my function. So this here is now the generation of my two-dimensional vector, and then I have to evaluate my function. So my function is f of xi, yi. So my function is the indicator function. So the indicator function, so if x squared plus y squared is smaller than 1, then return 1, it's my indicator function, otherwise return 0. Okay, so now I have created here this function which maps I to the evaluation f of xi, yi. And from that I can calculate the sum. Okay, so that is my integral. Well, the approximation of P is then the sum divided by the number of samples. Okay, so that's it. Yeah, so that looks quite easy. So that's the exercise. So let's print this approximation. And let's run this program. Let's keep fingers crossed. Well, looks okay. Yeah, 3.1415. Yeah, 926 would be the exact solution. Looks okay. So maybe I do not want to print out the P. I would like to print out the error. So let's define here the analytic value. So there is here a constant. And let's calculate here the error. So the error is the approximation minus the analytic value. So I can print the error. Okay, so the error is something like 10 to the minus 6, yeah? We know that the sequence has a discrepancy around 1 divided by n? Well, with respect to the dimension, it's log n to the power of d divided by n. So it's not exactly 1 divided by n. So it looks like this is in accordance with our results. Okay, so I like to compare this now to a parallelization. So maybe it's also nice to measure the time that we needed to calculate this. So I record here the time in milliseconds when we started the calculation. And here I record the time in milliseconds when we ended the calculation. So, and we have that the time in seconds is, the time in seconds is the end time minus the start time divided by 1000. And let's also print the time that was required to calculate this. Okay, so we needed 2.5 seconds to calculate this. Since I will do some more experiments, let's write a small headline and let's also write the output a little bit nicer. So let's write here some text. So what are we doing here? So here we are doing the Horton sequence is used. It's sequential. And we are using the Stream API. Okay, so, and maybe we go up to this point here. And then we write some nicely formatted string output. So first we write the error. So we write this in scientific notation. Then maybe a tabulator and we write the time. So the time is maybe then something like with three digits in seconds. Okay, so here we have error and time. So let's see if this looks nice. Let's check it. I would like to have a nice output here for this. Oops, unknown conversion. Okay, there is something missing here. Oh, this looks quite nice. So we can have a nice table then as the result. And maybe I also like to have here some nice headline of what we are doing. So what are we doing here? Monte Carlo approximation of P, and we are plotting the error and we are plotting the time. And let's plot some nice little line. Okay, don't know where that has to go. Okay, so maybe a little bit more space here. So maybe you should do this with a tabulator and a little bit other formatting tricks. But it's maybe okay for this code session. Okay, so next thing is let's do this now in parallel. So let's write another test Horton, with also streams, and let's do it in parallel. The nice thing is that now this stuff can be easily parallelized. So I need to implement that guy here. Okay, so let's move it here below so that I see the other code. So it can be easily parallelized because the thing that you have inside here is just a function of I, where every function evaluation is independent. Yeah? So the evaluation I doesn't care about the evaluation J. So it is embarrassingly parallel. So I can just copy here this code. And the nice thing is that the stream API just allows me to perform a parallelization by adding here the word parallel. So if you move here, then you see that this returns the same stream, and this stream is parallel. So it means that whenever an operation is coming after that, this framework automatically tries to split the task into parallel executions. So of course, I have to maybe change here my description. So now I'm doing it parallel using streams, and I'm done, I can run it. Okay, so that's nice. And I'm way faster. So in order to see a little bit more, yeah, let's take here 100 million. So 10 to the power of 8. Let's count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. So let's take a bit more to do. And check how long it takes. Okay, so that's really a difference, yeah? And you see the result is the same. To really see that we are doing something in parallel, let's have a look at the processors. So here you see a little bit how busy my processors are. So you see I have 8 cores, yeah? So maybe there's some hyper-threading behind this. So I have here 8 cores, and they are already a bit busy because this video conference here is consuming some calculation time. So let's run this experiment again. So you see now it's the first test that is running. It's sequential, so not all cores are used. You see a small increase here in the calculation time that is needed, or in the processing power that is needed. So you see a small increase in the processing power. Then after he has printed this, he is going in parallel. And you have seen for a short time that here all the guys were busy. Yeah? So there is this small peak here that is visible on every such core. So what we did was we did the Halton sequence. We did it with a sequential stream. We did the Halton sequence with a parallel stream. Let's try the next thing, the Mersenne twister. So our pseudo random number generator that we take from some library. So my next example is test Mersenne with the stream API. Let's take it first in sequential form. Okay, so let's move that here. So I do not want to write everything again. So let's start by just copying the code from our previous one. I remove the parallel because I would like to have a sequential stream here. So this is here Mersenne twister in sequential. We are using the stream API. Okay, so that one here has to be replaced. So the random number has to be replaced by a Mersenne twister random number generator. So let's get some random number generator. I use now a specific one. I use the implementation from the Apache Commons Math library, and well, a fairly old version. So there is a MathSynthesis in this library. So you don't have an implementation, you look up the internet, okay, where can you find an implementation of this, and you add the reference to this library to your Maven dependency, and then you can work with this library. So I have here an implementation of the MathSynthesis. So I create here a new version, a new implementation, a new object. So I create here a new object of this type. As an argument, you can specify a seed. So I will get in my Monte Carlo experiment always the same result. So, and then I can ask here, give me the random number. So I can ask here for a next double. And I populate now the two-dimensional vector by asking the one-dimensional sequence twice. So like we specified it in the lecture, create a two-dimensional sequence by using two elements for one-dimensional sequence to create one element of the two-dimensional sequence. And that should be it, okay? So we run through this stream here now in sequential order. So maybe I comment out here the other two. Yeah, so we will have a run over all in the end so that I do not have to wait for the other two. Maybe this one can be still here. Yeah, this one doesn't take so long. So now the first one should be the parallel stream here. Okay, so it was parallel for a short time. And then comes the MathSynthesis implementation. Whoa, and you see that this guy is really, really fast. Maybe let's compare all the guys. So maybe we compare all the three guys to see the difference in speed. So now the first one is the sequential using a Halton sequence. Yeah, so 20 seconds. Now the next one is the parallel using Halton, something like 4 or 5. Yeah. So, well, it's not scaling with the number of cores. Yeah. So I don't get out everything, but I get a nice improvement. And the last one is the MathSynthesis using a sequential stream, and it is slower than the parallel Halton, but it's faster than the sequential Halton. And the reason is that the Halton sequence, if the index is quite large, he needs to perform a lot of calculations to generate the number. Well, not a lot, but he needs to calculate some stuff. And the MathSynthesis implementation is actually more efficient. We will have a short look into the MathSynthesis implementation, but it's more efficient and it's quite fast. You also see that the error with the MathSynthesis pseudo-random number generator is much larger, okay? So I have something like I have for the number of samples a 10 to the 8. So 1 divided by n is a 10 to the minus 8. So this here is a 10 to the minus 7. Yeah, so there's a 9 here in front. So this here is like 1 divided by n. Yeah? So, and this here is like 1 divided by square root of n. Okay, so that fits to what we had for the convergence rate. So actually Halton is still better when you compare what you achieve in accuracy in that time. So let's comment the guys out here and try the next one. The next one should be MathSynthesis with a parallel stream. Okay, so we use a parallel stream. So this means I can just copy this code here. I write here, this is now parallel. Yeah, using the stream API, the function is called test mesen with stream parallel. And I just make a small modification. I tell him that he should use the stream and process everything that comes after this word in parallel. And let's see what's happening here. Okay, does this work? Well, bam. Okay, there's an issue. And this looks here quite cryptic. Yeah? So what is happening here? Index 624 out of bounds for length 624. Okay, so 623, that number appeared in the theorem or in the statement on the mesen twister. That's the dimension we can use in which the generator is generating an independent sequence. So somehow this number appears in the algorithm. So there's here the algorithm. And there is an error in this generator. So just from changing here the word parallel, or just by adding the word parallel to this, I get this error. Okay. So if I don't do this, everything works. Okay. Of course, now it's the sequential one, so this here is not true, but it works. So when I add here the word parallel, bam, I get this error. Okay, so what's happening here? So this is about thread safety. So multiple threads, so multiple parallel processing units. So they run in parallel. And if multiple threads run code that accesses a common field, so and here the common field is they all access a common, so the same, random number generator. This may lead to these inconsistencies of the state of this variable. Yeah? This is sometimes also called race condition. So assume you have here two threads that execute a program. Okay, and there is here some area in the memory where the two perform an operation. Okay, and then it may, for example, happen that this one here ask, okay, what is the number that is in this memory location? What is the number? So he will get a number. Then he would like to perform an operation, say plus one. And then he writes the number back to this location. And assume the other one likes to do the same. So assume now the other one looks, what is written in this memory location? He performs a certain operation, say plus one. And he writes the result back. Okay, that's a very usual situation. But a problem is if the order of the execution is, not one after the other, so they are interleaved because now it's running in parallel. So what happens if disk one first reads the number, say the number is zero, he reads zero. Then this guy is reading the number, he also reads zero. Okay, then this guy is performing the operation and it's writing the one. Okay, then the contents is one. And then this guy is writing his result, zero, he read the zero plus one is also one. I would have expected that after the two access, the number is two. One increment for the left guy, one increment for the other guy, it's two. But it's one because they first read the field, they performed the operation, and then they wrote the field. So if you are in such a situation, you need to synchronize the access to this field. So there is a cure to this situation. The cure is to synchronize the access to this field. So if threads need to modify a common shared object or field, then the access has to be synchronized. Okay, so what has this to do with our problem here? Well, I don't see an issue, yeah, because I just read the next number. Okay, so I'm not modifying the Mersenne twister. Well, that's not true. The Mersenne twister is a sequence and it stores internally something like a cursor. So where am I in the sequence? Okay, so this call next number will calculate the number, return it, and then it will increment some cursor. And actually these two calls are conflicting in the incrementation of this cursor. I can have a look at this, yeah? And you will actually maybe also understand why we have this issue. And this issue is of course related to the fact that this implementation here is not thread safe. Yeah? So this is about thread safety, and you if you have an implementation that tells you this implementation is thread safe, you can be sure that you can call it from multiple threads, at least if the programmer of this stuff has done everything right. Of course, there is another cure. Now you can make the code thread safe. Another cure is that each thread uses its own field. Yeah. So if this here is, for example, two different storing locations, then there's no conflict. So this is sometimes then called thread local. So if each thread has its own object, yeah, there's no conflict. And we will also do this as a cure to implement the Mersenne in parallel. So let's try to cure this here by synchronizing the access. So we have here multiple eyes, yeah, that go in parallel to the Mersenne. So I would actually like to synchronize here the access. So I define my X and Y here. I set the X and Y here. Okay, so let's first run it again to see that we still have the error. Okay, there's still the error. And we synchronize the access. So there's the word synchronized. You can use an object to for this synchronization. And this means that the stuff inside here is not allowed to be executed simultaneously by different threads. Okay, so now it runs, but you also see that it doesn't run really in parallel, okay? So it didn't use all my cores here. So the reason is that there is parallelism is forbidden inside here. And actually this is the largest part of the calculation, yeah, because this here is quite trivial. So using streams, and this is synchronized. So for the nerds, maybe have a look what is actually happening if you do not perform the synchronization. So let's have a deeper look into this error. Yeah. So let's create this error again. So you see here the stack trace, yeah, and you see that this is here our experiment, Monte Carlo integrator experiment. Lambda is this lambda expression, so this function, so lambda 3. And yeah, so because we already had three different ones defined. And there is here the Mersenne twister that has this error. So if you click here, you see the code of the Mersenne twister. And wait, this code looks really ugly. Yeah, a lot of bit operations, really ugly code. But it's not so long, and maybe we can understand what's happening here. Well, there is here this array MT. Yeah, so maybe I can have a look at the definition of this array. Okay, there is here this array MT, and the array has a certain size. Yeah? The size of this array here is, so MT is an integer array of size n, and the size of this array is 624. Huh? So there are 624 elements. So from 0 to 623. So if I ask this with element 624, it's out of bound. So this array has a specific size. And you see that the Mersenne twister is actually generating not one random number after the other. He is generating 624 random numbers at once. So he's generating a huge block, 624 integers at once. That's the reason it's not like a linear congruential random number generator on an integer, which has 32 bits, or on a long integer, which has 64 bits. Yeah? It is in a random number generator that has 624 times 32 bits. Yeah? Times 32, because it is 624 integers. So it is a huge word on which he is generating his random number. So he generates in this array here, in this loop. So there's a loop here going from 0 to n minus m, and then from n minus m to n minus 1, yeah, and then the last one is also populated. So in this loop, all the random numbers are populated. Of course, if I ask now for the next number, he is just checking where is my index. And if my index is inside this bunch of 624 numbers, then I can just return the number, and I can just increment this cursor. And when the cursor is at the end, I have to generate a new block, and I reset my index to 0. Okay, and now you can maybe understand what's happening here. We have now two simultaneous threads that are asking for this number. And by coincidence, the random number generator is now at the end of this block. Yeah? So there is only one number left. So I can return one number, and after that number, I should have generated a new one. Okay, so my index, the last number is at 623. So the index is at 623. So there's one number left. So now the first thread enters here and sees, okay, 623 is not large or equal 624. So I do not need to generate a new number because there's still a number left in my block. But the second thread comes along here at the same time and sees the same. Okay, 623, there's still a number left, so I do not need to generate a new number. So both threads are now at this point, and the index is at 623. There's one number left in the block. So the first thread is fetching this number, and he's incrementing the index. And then the second thread is looking at the number 624, which gives me this error. Okay, so you see that actually this code is not thread safe, and the guys that have implemented this could have made it thread safe by actually synchronizing this test here and the generation of the number, which would be maybe a bit more efficient than our synchronization, which is outside. Yeah, so we are synchronizing here outside. Okay, so the word synchronize here solves our problem. And now I have a mesh and twister, but it's not really parallel. Yeah, okay. So we see we get some result, but actually the time is, the time is even slower than what we have if we go sequential. The reason is that the overhead of generating multiple threads, so maybe let's have a look at all the results we did so far. Yeah, so we still have some time. So let's have a look at all the results we did so far. Okay, so you see the Mersenne parallel, yeah, is even slower than the sequential one. The reason is that the synchronization which we do here is actually removing all the efficiency from being parallel, and there is some overhead in performing the parallelization. Yeah, so you have to distribute all the tasks to the right guy, and well, that's not a good solution. So what we did was now the Mersenne twister sequence in sequential. Yeah, okay, that was quite nice. And we also did the Mersenne twister sequence using the parallel stream. Let's check the executor framework, which is maybe a little bit more code to write, yeah, but which is a little bit more specific to parallelization. So I add here another test. Let's try first the Mersenne. So test Mersenne with executor. This is then, of course, parallel. Okay, so and now I need to write a little bit of code. So I want to split my calculation in a different task. And now I do this by generating individual Mersenne twister sequences with different seed. So the thing which I mentioned, which is maybe not completely accurate, let's try it. So how many different subsequences do I like to have? So I like to have maybe 100 subsequences. And then I use 100 different tasks. So I have number of samples per task. Of course, here you should maybe take care about the thing that your number of samples maybe not be divisible by this number of tasks. Here it is the case, yeah. So you should check that there's nothing going wrong if this is not the case. So in our case, I would just would lose a little bit of accuracy. You know? So it's not an issue. So then I distribute these tasks to some executor. So there is an executor service. So there are here different executors which we can use. Yeah. So for example, a fixed thread pool that allows me to specify here the number of threads. So how many threads do I like to use? So number of threads are now the parallel execution workers that work on this. So I have 8 cores, yeah. So maybe I should use 8. You can ask here also how many processors has the machine. So I just use available processors. That will be on my machine an 8. Okay, so I use this executor service with now 8 different threads. Okay, so then let's create different task, and I create different task where each task has a different seed. So now I generate the seed with a random number generator. And let's have some seed for the generator of the seeds. So I need to import this here, and then I create my task. So for each task, so I have now a task index running from 0 to number of task. Okay, so for each of these 100 different tasks, so 100 different subsequences, let's take a seed from this random number generator. Okay. And then submit to the executor the calculation. So there is executor submit, and then comes a function that has no argument because you can just submit a task that he has to do. And this function is now get approximation of P with Mersenne Twister. And I pass as an argument the seed that I like to use, because every guy here has now a different seed. And I pass as argument the number of sample points, but now the number of sample points of this subsequence. So this is here now a Monte Carlo integral part, yeah, using just a partial number of sample points. Okay, so I have to write this this function here. No? So let's create here the function. So it's now here below. No? Here it returns an object, but actually I would like to return a double. Okay, and let's return for the time being a zero. I have to complete this then later. Okay, so this here will get me the result of a small Monte Carlo approximation. So what do I get as a return value here of this submit? Okay, so you see this submit returns a future double. Yeah? So it returns a future object that will give me a double once the calculation has completed. So let's define this. So this is now my future double, and this is here the value, the future value of this calculation. And now I need to collect all those results, yeah, because I will start many tasks here in this loop. So let's collect all those results in some list. So I have a list of future double results. Right. So you see, this is quite a bit more code than compared to the Stream API, but actually we are now really seeing what we are doing. So I'm distributing all those tasks, and now I add the result to this list. Okay, so when I'm now at this point here, I have started all the calculations. Yeah, so I have started this function here 100 times in parallel with different seeds. So now collect the results. So let's have maybe a small comment here. So this here is distribute the task, and this here is now collect the results. So I collect the results. So I calculate now the sum of the sums, yeah, or the average of the averages. So the sum is 0. Then I have a loop. So it's again a loop over all those tasks. So maybe I just copy this because I'm lazy. And I calculate here the sum is results get task index. So results is a list of futures. Get task index is the future. So if you look here, this is the future. And now from this future, I can call here this function get, which will get me the double value. And this call here will now wait until the task has finished. Yeah. So it's actually important that you do these two things here in different loops. Yeah. Because if you would do this here, he would start the task and wait for the task to finish. So he would not start the next task until the first task has finished. So I'm first starting all the workers and then I'm collecting all the results. Okay, and that's more or less it. Okay, there can be an exception here that the task is interrupted. So you have to add here a little bit of exception handling. I'm just throwing all the exceptions so that you would see some red output if something goes wrong. But that's now it. So now I have the sum and I calculate the approximation of P. So my approximation of P is now the sum divided by the number of tasks. Yeah? Okay, so I have n different approximations. N is now a number of tasks, or let's call it M. Yeah? So I have M different approximations. Yeah? Each is an approximation of P. So I have 1 divided by M, the sum of these approximations. And each individual approximation is a sum over a subsequence with n elements. Well, you have to be a little bit careful if you calculate here inside the sum over all elements and then divide here by the total number that you do not lose any points, but actually this here in this example is right, okay? So there can be some issue if there's some kind of rounding here, so that the number of samples per task multiplied with the number of tasks is not equal to the number of samples, yeah, because this is an integer division. Yeah, so you have to be careful in this. Okay, and then we have an approximation of P and we are done. Okay, so I can write now maybe a nice little output, so like we did here. So also let's calculate the time. So all this stuff here comes below. And I also record the time before I do all this. Yeah, so maybe here. Okay, so now the code is a little bit more lengthy here. But this is now Merzen parallel using executor. And we have thread local generator. Okay, so every thread, yeah, every task uses its own generator. Yeah, so that's it. I still have to implement here the approximation of P using the Mersenne twister. Let's complete that. So we use here now the same Mersenne twister as below. Okay, maybe I can just copy this here. So I use the same line for the Mersenne twister as below, but now with the seed here being the seed that is passed. So each one gets its individual seed. And then let's do it old school. I have a sum and I loop over all indices. And I calculate the Monte Carlo integral. Yeah? So I have double x is Mersenne, next double y is Mersenne, next double, and then this is in 0, 1, so I need to do my transformation. So this is 2 times Mersenne minus 1/2. So this is transforming the interval to minus 1, 1. Then I check the indicator function. If x times x plus y times y is smaller than one, sum is equal to sum plus one. Okay, otherwise not. And then I return sum divided by number of samples per task. So that's my Monte Carlo integral. Well, I still have the four times. That's the approximation of P. Let's keep fingers crossed that this is correct. Okay, so maybe I comment out a few guys here. So we can just, we do not need to wait so long. So the first one is the Mersenne with the stream. And the second one is the Mersenne now in parallel. Okay, so maybe I do the output a bit nicer. Okay, and you see this is really a gain, yeah? So it's now much faster. But you also see here, the error is different. Okay, so it's now in different order of magnitude. We can actually change here the seed, yeah? So let's use here a different seed. So this is now the seed of seeds. So he will generate different seeds for the 100 different sequences. So we have a different seed of seed for the 100 different sequences. And you see the number is changing. Well, I don't get into this region here. Let's try another one. No, it's a bit worse. Okay, so we are not using an individual sequence. We are using different sequences with different seeds. So maybe this is also somehow degrading the accuracy, but the accuracy is similar. It's way faster. So I'm look at four times faster, 3 to 4 times faster. Okay, so you can create another example also using the executor framework, using the Halton sequence. So maybe I skip that. It's just here get approximation of P with Halton, and then you can parallelize this. Actually, the parallelization with the Halton sequence has an advantage. Here you see that I get a different result, because actually it's not possible with this method to get the same sequence. In order to use this method and get the same sequence, I need a skip ahead feature. So maybe there is a Mersenne Twister implementation with a skip ahead, but using different seeds is generating a different sequence. With the Halton sequence, you can perform also this kind of parallelization here and you get the same result, yeah? Because you exactly know the subsequences. But we already did this with the Halton using the stream API, so maybe I do not need to do this. So maybe I run everything with, say, 200 million passes, so we see a little bit more output. Let me first check here the printout. So this guy has still a dot too much. Should be the last one here. Parallel stream. Synchronized, okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so to finish, let's run everything now with 200 million passes, 200 million sample points. So we have a little bit more to do. So which guy was first? The first guy is the sequential stream. So you see my processors here are, well, still a bit idle. And he's performing this calculation. So now this takes a bit of time. Also, the Horton sequence becomes slower if you go to higher indices, because you need to loop more. So that took now some 37 seconds. Now you really nicely see here that everything is going in parallel. So he's really busy. You saw some peak here on my CPU, and he gets a factor of 4. So that's nice. My CPU is already busy by 50%. Then Mersenne is quite fast, even in sequential order. It's almost in the region of the parallel Horton sequence. Okay, Mersenne parallel using stream had this issue of not being thread safe. Okay, so we needed to do the synchronization, and that's the guy that is running now. And you see that the synchronization leads to the problem that we are not really parallel. Still a little bit faster than the sequential stream. And then using this a little bit evil thing that we use different sequences with different seeds, we get a very fast calculation. So this guy here is way faster. It's not the same accuracy, because I do not have the same number here because I have different sequences, but the accuracy is in the similar region. So we completed this nice little exercise here. So we also did now Mersenne Twister with the executor framework. And what I didn't do in this session here was Horton sequence with the executor. But if you look here below, you can find the code for this on our GitHub repository. And here in the script, you have some results. These results were calculated without the video conference running, so the numbers are a little bit better. You see that here all those guys are the same. Okay, all those guys are the same because it's actually the same sequence, just with a different splitting. We also achieved this feature of this having the same here with the Mersenne, but the synchronization is here not efficient. Okay, so it solved the problem of the race condition, of the thread safetiness, but it's actually not sufficient. And of course, this guy here is Mersenne here with parallel on the executor framework using a thread local generator. So that is here due to the fact that every task has its own generator. Again, to stress this, each task here is executing this function, and each function has its own object, its own generator. So there's no conflict. So this one is, of course, here then very fast. Everything is, even the generation in the Mersenne is running now in parallel, and therefore we achieve this great performance. So that was it for this coding session.